got married, Da Vinci Code is going to be true. Carry on. Read Psalm 45, the whole of it.
It's not
going to
verse anyway.
Okay,
so,
read Psalm 45. Read Psalm 45.
So are you aware of
biblical prophecy? Right, I'm going to be aware now. Read Psalm 45 for everyone here.
No, hang on.
And then so tell us whether Jesus got married.
Okay, hang on. Verse 6 says, your throne.
Wait, what happened to verse 1? No, read the whole chapter. I want everyone to read the whole chapter.
Are you aware of prophetic? So, listen, in prophecy, yeah. Right? When David is giving his psalm.
I know what you're going to say, that Jesus is called Elohim in there, yeah?
No, that's not. No,
yeah, your throne, oh God, is forever. Hebrews chapter 1 applies that to Jesus. Get to the point.
Can I respond?
Yeah,
no,
I've heard all this before.
I'm just going to interrupt. All right. Like, finish. I want you to
do it. Okay. I'm done.
Your throne, oh God, is forever and ever. Okay? So this is, okay, your throne, oh God, is forever and ever. The scepter of your kingdom is a scepter of uprightness. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, so this is David speaking, and he's saying, therefore, God, your God have anointed you. So this is God calling, saying to God, has anointed you with the oil
God
of gladness.
God is saying to God, okay, carry on.
Yes,
okay.
Which makes sense.
God is saying to God, alright.
Yes, this is God the Father, okay. Saying to God the Son. Because it says, okay. Therefore God.
God is saying to God, carry
God the Father, yeah. Saying to God the Son.
Okay.
Therefore has your God has anointed you with oil of gladness beyond your companion.
Before you carry on, God the Father said to God the Son that your God the Son's God has anointed you.
So hang on.
Yeah?
Hang on. What I'm saying to you is that if you look at prophecy, including Psalm 110, which Jesus quoted, yeah. And said that how can it, you know, Messianic prophecy, how can the Son of David both be Jesus?
You have to deal with one at a time.
No.
Choose one. No. Psalms 110 or 45, you can't jump back. Choose one. And then we'll talk about
it. You know what? You're a speaker, I won't interrupt you. Speak and I speak, that's it.
Alright then, I won't interrupt you, but all I would say is choose one for now. Psalms 110 or Psalms 45. We deal with one at a time. So choose which one you want to discuss and then I'll be quiet. Is it Psalms 45 or is it Psalms 110? Yeah, but I can't jump between both of them. Choose one for you.
I'm discussing
one. Okay, carry on.
So, my brother here got a scripture to say from Matthew 12 and
9
to say,
yeah.
Jesus is saying, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one.
Yeah.
And then,
yeah.
Yeah, the Lord your God.
Adonai.
Is one. Yeah. Okay, and Jesus says that, highly honored, verse 25 to say, that, he says that, you know, he's full of how can we both be followed David? How can we both be David?
That's not what he says.
No, let me quote.
You see, if you're going to say what he's going to say, say what he's going to give your own spin on it. He says to the Jews,
what's the verse again? Psalms
110. Which they mistranslate.
Because he's the creator of it. He's the creator. What is it?
Listen, I've got to be gone in an hour, so please.
And Jesus said, the Christ is the Son of David.
Yeah.
David called himself in the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Declared, the Lord said to my Lord.
Yeah. Okay.
Sit at my right hand until I kill your enemies.
Yeah.
That's the Lord.
Okay. Okay. So what is the point?
David
is asking
David himself calls him Lord.
Yeah.
David himself is calling him the Messiah.
Okay.
So how?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. What's your ruling?
Jesus is
both the Christ.
Okay.
The Son of David.
Okay.
Also,
okay. So you finish your point.
Okay. So can you answer that then?
Okay.
How is Jesus both the Son of David?
Okay. See, the problem is you've given interpretation to it that is different to what your own biblical scholars say.
Listen,
I let you speak now. Can you let me speak now?
Let him speak now.
Let me speak. Jesus said to them, yeah, that you Jews, you scribes are claiming that the Messiah has to come from David. But if that was the case, how could David refer to his own descendant as Adon E? That was his point. According to biblical scholars, yeah, E.B. Sanders and scholars like that, the biblical Jesus of Mark was denying that he's from David. So he's saying to the Jews that you're not.
One second.
From this passage, what is?
When are you denying?
Can you let me finish? He,
Where did he say?
Where did he say, I am the son of David?
He's getting them to think.
No, no, you tell me, where did he say, I am the son of David? Where did he say, I am the son of David?
Is he the Messiah?
Well, does the Messiah have to be from David?
Yes.
Who said that?
According to, are you saying that according to prophecies from the Old Testament?
Which one?
The Messiah.
Which one?
This one, for example.
Psalm 110. Where did Psalm 110?
The Jewish and the Muslim, clearly in the context, the Jewish at the time knew that the Messiah is the son of David.
The Jews, some Jews said that, some Jews. If you go to the Dead Sea Scrolls, they were waiting for a Messiah from the tribe of Aaron. The Jews today, even in the Talmud, are waiting for a Messiah from the tribe of Joseph. So which Messiah are you on about? So which biblical prophecy, according to your Old Testament, says that the Messiah has to be from David? Okay, some you interpret, but you're going to have to prove to me that's about the Messiah. And back to Psalms 110.
Is your point that the Messiah is not the son of David?
What my point is, and as biblical scholars have pointed out, Jesus is saying to the scribes that you lot are claiming that the Messiah is from David, but if that was the case, how could David refer to him as Adoni in Psalms 110? He would not refer to his descendant as Adoni if the Messiah was really his descendant, implying the Messiah is not from David, and that's an erroneous idea from the scribes.
So
that's what your biblical scholars say.
Are you saying that the Messiah is not from David?
Yes, because Jesus is not from David. Jesus is not from David.
Do you believe David was a prophet, by the way?
Forget that, we already got a clip of Godwin.
Yeah, it was a good one, Godwin.
Was he a prophet?
Very nice video, by the way.
Nice one, man.
Was he given prophethood by God?
He was a prophet. Okay, so listen.
Was Muhammad a prophet? That's a good question.
Okay, Psalm
110. Let's talk about Muhammad.
I'll get to you, don't worry.
I'll get to you.
Godwin, you got destroyed. It doesn't make a difference for Christianity.
If Muhammad is not a prophet,
Godwin,
you're in big trouble.
Godwin, you're being a bit rude.
But if Muhammad is not a prophet, your faith is dead. You understand what that means?
You get battered. You get battered on that video, man.
You see what I'm saying?
I've never seen you ever debate my life. I've never seen you talk to a Christian. And you've got a lot of nerve. I'm challenging you now.
Right now.
Right.
You see, a lot of people can talk from the sidelines. You can make a lot of YouTube comments. But you cannot debate.
I'm challenging you now.
I've never seen you debate no one in my life.
I'm debating you.
I've seen this guy debate. I've seen him debate. But I've never seen you. Who are you? What's your name? Where did you come from?
He's our teacher.
You're a teacher, and you can't even defend your own. Have you seen me speaking before? You sit on your armchair, you're a couch commentator.
Destroyed.
You destroyed me, really. You talk a lot, but you can't back it.
You talk away.
backwards.
Come. You want to steal the show? Come, let's debate.
So,
the topic. So, the topic of, I was looking at Matthew 12,
verse 29.
12:29 that said that.
Don't ask him. He's going to be in trouble even more.
No, he's not going to get in. So, he was saying that when Jesus says the Lord your God in one,
he's the worst person to ask.
Why don't you look at the context of it? Because in verse 35, Jesus said, how come the Messiah is both Lord, son of David, and both Lord?
Okay. Yeah, we'll get. Are you having that conversation now?
Yeah,
no, I'll tell you what, you finish that conversation. Till today, I've been coming to Speaker's Corner for 2 years, right? I've never heard a Muslim
give me
a reason why Muhammad is a prophet. Now, this is important. Hashim did not tell me. Oh, you can repeat what Hashim said if you want. Okay? All right, so I want a Muslim. Just finish here. Finish that. I'm going to wait.
I'll home for you, don't worry.
No, I'll be right here. I'm not going nowhere.
Good.
So you're going to prove to me. You're going to prove to me that Muhammad is a prophet.
More popular.
Yeah.
Good win.
So you're going to prove to me Muhammad is a prophet.
We'll make you celebrate.
No problem.
We'll make you famous. Trust me.
Everyone's talking about you, friend.
We'll make you famous.
I debate. Everyone's talking about you.
What was it? What
are you talking about?
We'll make you famous.
I don't need to be famous.
He's famous.
It's not about me. It's about Jesus. It's about Jesus.
It's about David.
God is using him. David has nothing to do with Christianity.
David has nothing to do with Christianity.
David, okay, does not make a difference whether you're a Christian or not.
You have.
But if Muhammad, Hold on, listen. I'll tell you what you do. Finish your conversation. You can't say one thing and then that ends.
You said David.
Let's start now. Yeah.
No, one minute.
I haven't even finished the conversation. Okay, we're going
to
start.
You said David's got nothing to do with Christianity.
That's what I said.
If David never got married, he'd have the kingdom to be no Messiah.
Now you change the subject.
Is he a prophet? Is he a prophet? Yes or no?
Finish what you're going to say. And I mean, you're going to talk. I want one Muslim to prove to me Muhammad's a prophet.
Okay, let's finish this.
I'm going to wait right here.
Okay. Is it the best you have?
And you can also tell me where Muhammad is in the Bible.
Okay, you can do that afterwards. Also, yeah, when you say one Muslim, do you mean three in one or one?
No. See, that's the problem. That's the problem. Every Muslim, will always run to the Trinity. Always run to Jesus.
No, because
they don't ask the question.
I'm being serious.
You know what? Directly, let's just start now.
No, because in other words, one.
When we even start,
I'm being serious. No,
what's your name, brother?
Zakir. I'm not joking because in one minute, let me explain.
No.
Yeah. The word one in English is complex because in English we can say night and day made one day. A table and chairs made one set. It's complex, so when you say one apple, it can mean three in one. Like Ehad and Ibu. Okay, let's start. You're right. Should we start with him? Okay, I'll have a debate with you. Let's set the rules now because I've seen your last debate. 2 minutes apiece. 2 minutes apiece.
Let's just dialogue.
No. 2 minutes apiece.
No. Okay, I promise.
2 minutes apiece.
Listen,
back and forth.
Back and forth. Yeah. So what I'm saying to you, listen, yeah, we'll have a conversation. I promise I'll let you finish if you promise you let me finish.
Yeah, but 2 minutes apiece.
No.
Just keep time.
No, you're not gonna. We have to agree.
We have to agree. We have to agree.
Otherwise, we're not gonna debate. Okay. We have to agree. So I'll agree to let you finish what you're saying, okay? If you let me finish what I'm saying. And so there could be questions. I could have a question to you. You can question me, okay? There's a dialogue.
On top of that. Okay, on top of that, I agree with that. On top of that, when I make certain points, I've debated this topic before, so I know what I'm talking about. I don't want you to start saying to the crowd it's irrelevant, because whatever I'm going to say is going to be connected to the topic.
No. Fair enough? If you allow me to finish what I'm saying, I'll allow you to finish what you're saying.
All right.
Respectfully, yeah?
Okay.
So
we're
going to respect each other.
One last thing. How will we know when we're dragging on too
long? So when I finish, I'll let you know. Trust me, I'm not going to go. I'm going to be right to the point.
But bro, what if you've got 5 minutes?
All right, so the question is this, okay?
You're going to keep on going.
The question is this.
Just make it 1 minute, 1 minute.
Okay, the reason why... And I'm hoping that you can be the Muslim champion today, yeah? The reason why is because I've been asking this question for many years, okay? And no Muslims, I've spoken to imams, I've spoken to sheikhs, I've spoken to various Muslims. The question is this, okay? You have Muhammad, okay? You believe he's your prophet. You believe he's the last, or you believe he's the seal of the prophets, okay? Alright, and so you say that he was the last prophet. The question I'm asking to you, okay? Why do you believe Muhammad is a prophet? This is a question I've been asked for many years. I haven't got an answer. Can you answer why Muhammad is a prophet?
You don't.
I've done.
Okay. By the way, I'm going to set something clear here. I'm a Cohen, by the way. Yeah?
What's Cohen?
I'm from the tribe of Levi, yeah? Now, we knew about the last prophet to come.
The tribe of Levi, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. We knew about the last prophet to come in the land of the Arabs. We knew about this from the start. Our scriptures testified to the fact that a prophet would arise in the land of Kedah. That's point number one. He was foretold in our scriptures. So that's a proof that he was a prophet. Number two, yeah. The prophet on whom he peace, he foretold the future. He gave miracles at the prophecies of the future. Number three, he did miracles. The miracles strengthened his prophethood. Number four, he gave us key doctrine that sorted out our erroneous creed. A lot of things had crept into the creed of the children of Israel to the point where we were stuck in confusion. Like, does God change his mind? The Bible says yes. Does God not change his mind? The Bible says yes. Which one is it? The Prophet Muhammad, on whom he peace, he corrected our theology, and our theology was perfect and doctrine was perfect from that day forward. Number five, he was a sincere individual. So these are some of the reasons why he was a prophet. Yeah, the prophet, the Quran is a linguistic miracle of the Prophet, peace be upon him. It contains prophecies of the future, etc. And it's the most perfect and eloquent speech. So at the end of the day, whatever,
do you have your Bible with you? I need your Bible.
Whatever proof you give to why you believe Jesus is a prophet, Muhammad on whom be peace, is three times more proof as a prophet through those methods. Christians say, I haven't finished yet. Christians say, when Jews ask the Christian, why do you believe Jesus is the Messiah? Old Testament. Why do you believe Jesus is the Messiah? Miracle. Why do you believe Jesus is the Messiah? Prophecies of the future. So whatever proof you got for Jesus being a prophet, Muhammad on whom be peace, with that same proof, will be three times over. Back to you.
Okay. So this is the reason why I like Daniel. One of the first things you said, you mentioned Kedah, yeah? So you said that he's prophesied in Kedah, that he's gonna a prophet will come from Kedah. Wait, can you show us where it says that a prophet will come from Kedah?
Yeah. Alright, Isaiah chapter 42.
Okay, can we go to Isaiah 42?
Okay. Isaiah chapter 35.
Wait.
Psalm go. Chapter 84.
Don't get excited.
Isaiah 42. Yeah.
Isaiah 42. Yep.
Can you read it?
You want me to read it?
Yeah. If you read it, yeah, please. Yeah. If you read Isaiah 42. Yeah.
Read it so we can all hear.
Here is my servant who I behold. Can you guys hear me?
Who I uphold.
My chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him and he will bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break. Did Muhammad
say that? Yeah, it is.
And a smoldering, tree.
Carry on. A smoldering wick he will not snuff out. In faithfulness he will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged till he establish justice on earth. In his teaching, the island will put their hope. This is what God the Lord says, the grace of heaven, who stretches them out, who spreads out the earth with that spring from it, who gives breath. Do you want me to read the whole thing?
Okay, no, that's good. What we're going to do, we're going to break down this verse, okay? Right? You've got time to do this. We're going to break down the verse, and then we're going to see if it's really speaking about Muhammad.
Okay.
Yeah? Because you said this has to be speaking about Muhammad. Okay. So let's go verse by verse, yeah? Verse one. What's the verse one?
Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight.
Right. This verse, yeah? Okay, right. So it speaks about I'll put my spirit on him, okay? So first of all, if you can let me break this down, and then I'll promise I'll let you speak afterwards, yeah? First of all, the book of Isaiah 61, Jesus himself says...
51.
61, yeah? 61, verse 1. Says Jesus himself, okay? And in Luke, in the book of Luke, 4:18, okay? He refers to the scripture and he says, this is how I'm fulfilling the scripture.
Yeah.
So the spirit of the Lord is
in
upon
temple,
you,
yeah.
Okay? Right here, it says, I will put my spirit on him.
Yeah.
Okay? So read the next verse. I just want to make it clear that this is Jesus. Then I'll make it clear that it cannot be Muhammad.
Before you get to the next verse,
let me finish. No. I want to break it down. Okay. We've got time. And then you're going to go for it, yeah? Alright. So that's verse 1. The spirit of the Lord is upon him.
Alright.
I haven't read anything.
The prophet was strengthened with the spirit. So carry on.
No. The spirit of the Lord is upon him.
Okay. So he next came verse. That too. Carry on.
Verse 1. The next verse.
What's it, Godwin?
Hold on.
watch it. Before you get the next verse, let's finish this verse so we can be on equal par. Okay. Okay. I'm not gonna like explain 10 verses.
I'll tell you what we do. I'll tell you what we do. I'll show where Jesus fulfilled it. And if you could quickly go to the book of Matthew.
Look, you don't need to. It's Luke when he's in the temple at the age of 12.
No, no.
He quotes Isaiah 61.
You're wrong.
The Lord
you're
has wrong. Anointed me. That's the one you're
wrong.
About.
No, you're not. No, I'm not.
All right, you're not about Isaiah 41 or anything.
So, let's go to Matthew chapter 12. You got Matthew chapter 12? Yeah, verses 16.
Verse 16?
Yes. Where are we?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So if you read... Okay, yeah, read that, verse 12. Start from 15 and then read down.
Okay. Aware of this, Jesus withdrew from that place. A large crowd followed him, and he healed all who were ill. He warned them not to tell others about him. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah.
So this was to what?
Fulfill what was spoken through
the
prophet
Now read the next verse.
Well, that's good. Here is my servant.
Here is my servant, yeah.
Okay. Whom I have chosen.
Yes.
The one I love.
Yes.
In whom I delight.
Okay. No, sorry. I just love the word of God. Go on.
That is really good.
Yeah.
I will put my spirit on him, and he will proclaim justice to the nation.
Okay.
He will not quarrel or cry out.
Okay.
No one will hear his voice in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out.
Okay.
He has brought justice through the... Oh, wow, that's really good.
Okay. Bruce keep reading. Keep reading. Read it down.
In his name, the nations will put their hope.
All right. So that is literally what we just read in Isaiah. Jesus Christ fulfilled it.
Okay.
How dare you put your Muhammad in our holy book? How dare you put your Muhammad in our holy book? It's fulfilled by Jesus.
Okay.
And it's clear in Matthew.
Okay.
Right. Do you have another text? Yes, I'm done.
Okay.
Yes.
So according to Godwin, if there's an Old Testament prophecy and Matthew claims it's about Jesus, somehow that's a full stop. If I told you a companion of the prophet quoted Isaiah 42, about Muhammad, does that end the story as well?
I'm asking you a question.
Okay. So if I quoted a companion of the prophet who directly quoted from Isaiah 42 and said this is about Muhammad, would that prove it's about him?
Zakir, you cannot do that. One. Number one.
Why can't I do that?
Wait, hold on. Okay. Give it.
I'm asking you.
Isaiah, you tried to use the Bible as your proof text.
Okay.
Yeah? So let's use the Bible.
I use Isaiah, not Matthew.
Yes, you use Isaiah.
Isaiah's a different book.
Is the whole of Isaiah true?
Not all of it.
Okay. So now you're going to the Bible and you're saying that I'm going to use the Bible as my proof text.
Okay.
But yet you're saying it's not true.
All right.
Can you not see the contradiction?
Okay. Is the whole of Psalm 22 true?
No. Wait. Let's
the whole of Psalm 22 true?
We'll go to that in a minute.
Is the whole of Psalm 22 true? Wait,
hold on.
Yes
hold
or
on,
no?
Hold on. Yes, the whole of Psalm 22 true.
So when the Jews say it doesn't say Pierce, that's true.
Don't change the subject.
Is that true?
Okay.
Remember, you believe it's corrupted as well?
We don't want to talk over each other.
Okay.
I'm still making my point.
So let me finish my point.
No.
You read the whole passage?
I read the passage, but I haven't finished my point.
This is why we need to stick to 2 minutes and 2 minutes.
So, okay.
This is why we need to stick to 2 minutes.
But I haven't finished my point.
No, but you read the whole passage, left it to me, and jumped back in.
No, hold on. We didn't see there was a timer. We didn't see there was a timer.
So let me finish
his point.
No, you didn't make a point. I just read the text.
I made a point.
Let him respond to that.
He's responding to your thing. He hasn't finished. He jumped in.
You got to be fair.
What I was saying is, I have to read the text.
Okay.
And then I have to explain it.
Okay.
I'm just going to read it to you and say, you make up your mind.
Okay.
Yes, the text is self-explanatory. But I still want to explain it.
Okay, no problem.
Okay. And I also want to. Wait, hold on. I also want to prove why it cannot be Muhammad.
Okay.
I don't want to just prove it's Jesus.
Disprove
I want to prove why it's not Muhammad. Can I prove that? Why it cannot be Muhammad?
Okay.
Alright. So let's go for each verse at a time, back to 42. Clearly
each verse at a time, let's deal with verse 1 first.
But I just showed you that it's fulfilled by Jesus.
Let me respond.
Yes, Eleni,
let me respond.
Okay.
Yeah, this is what I mean. Now, according to Godwin's logic here, if there's a prophecy in the Old Testament and Matthew, Tom, Dick, and Harry claims it's about Jesus, somehow there's a full stop, case closed. Yeah, but there's not a case closed. That's Matthew claiming this about Jesus. So if I quote the companion of Prophet Muhammad on Rumbi P saying it's about the Prophet, is he going to accept that? No. So let's go back to the text. The very text in Isaiah 42, the verses that Matthew claimed Jesus fulfilled, says that this servant will be for the nations, for the Gentiles. But the historical Jesus was not for the Gentiles. He in fact, Matthew chapter 15, he called a Gentile woman a dog. He was not going to heal her until she defeated him in wisdom. And then she said to him, even dogs eat under the master's table. And then he healed her. Does that sound like a lie to the Gentiles? Whereas Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, Surah 7, Ayah 158, Allah told him to say what? O mankind, I am a prophet sent unto you all, not that you are dogs. So that text of Isaiah 42 about a servant going to the Gentiles fits Prophet Muhammad and whom be peace, but the biblical Jesus of Matthew chapter 15 thinks the non-Jews are dogs. Over to you.
So 1-0. You're still stuck. Okay, so I've clearly shown you, okay, that in the Bible, because you use the Bible as your proof text, I've shown you within the Bible that it's fulfilled through Jesus Christ.
No, that Matthew claims.
Is Matthew in the Bible?
Yes.
Right, so that's what I said.
It's Matthew, Isaiah.
Hold on.
Matthew, Isaiah.
I said that it's fulfilled in the Bible. That's what I'm
saying. The New Testament claims it's fulfilled. So Jews don't accept Matthew.
Two things I want to do. Because you want to stick on Isaiah. Let's look at Isaiah really quickly. Isaiah, before I show that it cannot be Muhammad.
Right? But show how
I'm going to show it's not Muhammad. Wait. Okay. Can you get me Isaiah? Isaiah chapter.
Well, deal with my point.
Isaiah 21:16.
Deal with my point.
I will do your point.
I just don't want to go to Isaiah 21. It's going to prove my point again. Are you sure you want to go to Isaiah 21?
It's going to prove
your point. Go to it.
Okay.
21:16.
All right then. He hasn't responded to Jesus calling Gentiles dogs. That don't sound like a lie to the Gentiles.
Why are you doing
Isaiah 42? The person that Isaiah 42 has to be for the Gentiles. So how is it not related?
No, because Jesus didn't come from the Gentiles.
Say that again.
God so loved the world. What did Jesus say?
God so loved the world. Number one, there's a dispute whether Jesus said that. Number two, Calvinists don't believe that's about the whole world. And the Calvinists, you heard of them. We'll see their commentaries on it.
Yeah? Hold on one second. I just want to get Isaiah 21.
Okay. You sure you want to go to Isaiah 21?
Yes, I do.
Godwin, I feel sorry for you.
I've just proved.
Yeah, okay. After what you did in the David video, do not go to Isaiah 21.
Listen, if Muhammad is not a prophet, right? Islam is dead. Can we agree on that?
Yes.
If Jesus or if David, okay, is not a prophet, Christianity still lives on. It's irrelevant. If David,
the Holy Spirit,
hold on. Because you're changing the subject. We're going to go back to Isaiah. Hold on to that.
Okay.
If David is not a prophet, okay, Christianity is still alive and kicking. It's still alive and kicking.
So
Jesus still died. Okay. Jesus still rose again. Alive. But if Muhammad is not a prophet, you're in big trouble.
Okay, so you're saying.
Do you understand the significance of what we're talking about?
No, I don't understand.
Okay. Well, let's stick to the subject. Isaiah, wait, hold on.
I can't respond to
Isaiah.
He's not letting me speak.
No. We're not changing the subject.
No. Yeah, but listen, he just said that if David is not a prophet, Christianity lives on. But if the Holy Spirit got that detail wrong in Acts, the New Testament is false. And that's the same New Testament that told you
Jesus rose from the dead. You don't understand the Bible clearly.
That's the same New Testament that said Jesus rose from the dead. So if the New Testament's wrong, then Christianity is dead. And it won't rise up after two nights and one day.
So you said, okay, so you tried to use Isaiah as your proof text.
Yeah, so far, I've proven it.
You haven't proved it.
Okay,
I've showed you, just put it over, sir. I've showed you, that it's been fulfilled. Okay,
no,
in
Matthew
the Bible.
Claimed it. Matthew well, claimed
that's your business with you, okay, in the Bible or not.
So answer my question.
Wait, hold on. Now, you said that this prophet comes from Kedar, okay? So I want to look at this Kedar for a minute, yeah? All right, so it says here, For thus the Lord said to me, in a year as a hired man would count it all, the splendor of Kedar will be terminated.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. So it's saying within a year of Isaiah writing, the splendor of Kedar will be terminated. Look at the other words. Will be destroyed. Will come to an end. Okay. And then if you right? And so Muhammad comes how many hundred years after Isaiah?
About 1,000 years.
1,000 years. Yeah. Okay?
Okay.
And you're claiming that he came from Kedar when it's been destroyed and terminated. Yeah.
Okay.
Show us how.
Okay.
When it says it'll be terminated.
My question to you is, you know that word?
Well, don't change the subject. Stick to it. No, you want to use Isaiah. Stick to that. Okay, respond to that question.
I haven't even spoken.
Respond to that question.
Okay, you're going to be quiet now?
Yes, I am.
You promise?
Yes, I am.
On the Holy Spirit?
Big trouble today.
Okay. Point number one, I want to recall everybody that so far, Isaiah 42, the passage that he quoted and Matthew claimed Jesus fulfilled, speaks about a servant for the Gentiles. The prophet on whom be peace was told in Surah 7, Ayah 158, I am for all of mankind. whereas Jesus called Gentiles dogs. So far it's 1-0 to me. Yeah?
Let me finish the question.
No, we'll come to Gentiles.
And one more thing, I'm being serious. If I get interrupted one more time, I'm going to walk off. So you either do 2 minutes or 2 minutes. Now he mentioned Isaiah 21, yeah?
Yes, 21.
Now I'm going to ask him a question about this verse. What historical event is this speaking about?
It simply says, okay, in Isaiah,
what is he speaking about?
It's simply saying that Kedar, okay. I'll read it again.
No, I don't need you to read it. I want you to tell me. Do you know what it's speaking
according
about?
According to the Bible,
what is it speaking
it's saying
about?
Kedar, okay, which you claim Muhammad, yes, was from, okay, will be come to an end, okay, will be terminated. There'll be no more Kedar.
Okay.
This is the book that you've chosen, okay? Now what I'm saying to you is, okay, how is it possible, okay, that Muhammad's going to come, okay, from there when it no longer exists?
I'm asking you a simple question to carry on my point.
Right.
So you have to work with me.
Yes.
My point is, do you know what historical event this is speaking about?
The historical event is that Kedar will be destroyed.
Has it happened?
Yes, it came to an end.
Okay, when?
Within a year. Did you not read it? Did you not read the text?
So within a year, Kedar?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Within a year?
According to this.
Okay, he's referred to himself badly.
Oh, really? Okay, sure.
Okay, so Kedar didn't exist after chapter 21.
No.
Okay, thank
this
you.
This guy is really
referred to himself.
I'm going to try and calm down.
Okay.
Because within a year of that chapter.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, no one interrupt. He's done a bigger blunder than he did with David. And now he's going to have to apologize to the camera. If what he's saying is true, that Kedar didn't exist after Isaiah chapter 21, then how come Isaiah 42 says that the people at Kedar shall rejoice?
That's not what I said. Let me tell you why it's not gonna happen. Okay.
Okay.
What you have to now explain, right? Okay, is clearly you're saying this is it. Clearly you're saying that you're trying to use Isaiah as your proof text. In the book of Isaiah, okay, right, it says clearly in 21, right, that Kedar will be terminated. You said it's 1,000 years before Muhammad. Then you claim that Muhammad is from Kedar, which, according to the text you want to use, is destroyed. Okay. Now, what you have to ask yourself is this. Okay.
So you're interpreting it wrong.
Hold on. You have to prove that Isaiah 42 was written a year out or 21 within that year.
Okay.
Okay. You've got to prove that.
Okay.
Right. Can you prove chronologically?
No problem.
That 42 was written a year afterwards. Okay, can you prove that?
No problem. He's got a bigger issue now.
Listen, just stop talking.
I'll respond to him in sign language because he told me to stop talking.
Prove that. Yeah. Prove it. Stop. You're talking to everyone and you think you're getting excited.
Okay. Everybody, he said the Isaiah 21. I'm going to refute him on that. I told him not to bring it up. It's worse than the David point.
Verse 6.
But anyway, okay. It's worse than it. He said that according to Isaiah 21, Kedar is going to be terminated. But yeah, according to him, Isaiah 42 is talking about Jesus. But when he comes, Kedar will rejoice. How could somebody who died 700 years before Jesus rejoice?
You didn't even respond to my question.
Which means that they still exist.
You didn't even respond to my question.
Which means they still exist. Still
existing. I'm going to ask the question one more time.
Because you're clearly being deceptive.
Now you've got a worse point.
You're being deceptive. Wait, hold on.
Let me finish.
Again.
Okay.
Right. Again, I said to you. In Isaiah 42,
yeah,
you have to prove, okay?
Yeah.
If you're saying, in the text, it says in verse 21:16, it says within a year. You've got
within 3 years according to the Dead Sea
Scrolls. It says
Dead Sea Scrolls.
Stop changing.
Within three years.
Stick to the text, okay?
Yeah. Three years, Dead Sea Scrolls.
You see, you're going to cut me off. Okay, in the text, it says within a year. Now, if you're saying, okay, that because if you're saying it would have happened many years afterwards and it could have been verse 32,
okay,
you have to prove that Isaiah did not write 42 within that year. You have to prove that chronologically. Can you do that? That's a direct question. Can you prove that Isaiah 42 was not written within a year? Prove that.
Okay, number one, your question does not make
sense. Don't change the subject, prove that.
Your question does not make sense. Because first you give the erroneous interpretation to Isaiah 21 that the Kedah shall cease to exist.
You can't prove it, let's go to the next point.
No. Listen, you're not cutting me off. You're not cutting me off again. Stop now. Now everybody, the list of problems for Godwin increases. It increases worse.
Listen, talking doesn't help.
One minute. Talking doesn't help. Why are you talking for? Okay. All right, 1 second. The first mistake Godwin said, was that Isaiah 42, because Matthew claimed this about Jesus, refers to Jesus, but Jesus called Gentiles a dog. The prophet said he's for all of mankind. 1-0 to me. Then he said,
1-0 to
me. Yes. then he said, if I can't David in the 2-0, but number two, he said in Isaiah chapter 21, he never gave no historical context, never even explained the text properly. He says, it said, Kedah shall fail, they shall cease to exist. But according to him, in chapter 42, it's a prophecy of Jesus, which means Kedah would have had to exist at the time of Jesus.
Exactly.
That was erroneous point number two, which is 2-0 to me. Now the third point, which is going to refute you thoroughly, Isaiah 21 has to be talking about after the time of Jesus. Shall I tell you why? Because the verses before what he quoted, it says, ye Dedanites, the Dedanites, you shall dwell in the thickets of Arabia. Now, if you go to historical sources, the Dedanites moved to Arabia after the Roman exile in the first and the second century, which means this prophecy has to be after the time of Jesus. Point number one. Point number two, then it speaks about an event after the time of the Dedanites that somebody will be fleeing from the bow of Kedah, and that people should give him refuge, give him bread, and the splendor of Kedah shall fail. What does that refer to? When the Prophet Muhammad, anhum be peace, he left Makkah, and Abu Jahl and them were trying to kill the Prophet, and he went to Medina, and they fed him bread, they took him in. And what happened within 3 years, according to Dead Sea Scrolls? The Battle of Badr, the pagans of Arabia, the pagans of Makkah, the Kedah, they were destroyed. Their glory was destroyed. 300 of them died in the Battle of Badr. Isaiah foretold that. So 3-0 to me, or is it 4-0? Last point before I leave. I want
you to leave. You're gonna run?
No, I mean leave. Leave it to you. I don't need to run nobody. Yeah. The last point, I want everybody to pay attention, and I want him to tell me how Isaiah 42, the very verses he quoted, refer to Jesus when he called the Gentiles a dog, and he only healed her because she defeated him in wisdom, and it doesn't refer to Prophet Muhammad and Ubi's. Don't run from that point. Okay, over to you.
Okay, so I'm going to move on because I've asked you, I'm going to continue. I'm going to continue on in Isaiah 42 to show that this is Jesus. I've really thought. Verse 42, chapter 42, verse 1. Okay, right. So, two things I want to make very, very clear. Number one thing that was clear in the text, Jesus in the book of Matthew chapter 12, okay, is fulfilled. The very same chapter, the Bible speaks about Jesus fulfilling it in Matthew chapter 12. That's clear. Okay. Number two, in Isaiah chapter 21, it says that take care that we terminate it. I've been asked you, can you prove? Okay, that Isaiah in chapter 42, that he wrote this after a 1 year. You couldn't prove that. You just started waffling about all other things. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to this verse and I continue on proving why it's Jesus and why it's not Muhammad. So let's continue. Isaiah 42. Right, so we're going to speak about, so we spoke about verse 1, which speaks about the Spirit of the Lord is upon me.
Yeah.
Okay? And it says, the Bible says that he will bring justice, keep reading it. I will put the Spirit of the Lord, and he will bring justice to the nations.
Yeah, okay. So it says, did Jesus fulfill that?
Can you not cut me off? Yes. He will bring justice to all the nations. In the book of John chapter 5 verse 22, Acts 17, 30, Ecclesiastic 12, 13, check it out. It speaks over and over again, it speaks about Jesus Christ coming to bring judgment to all mankind, to all nations. Jesus Christ, no one else, Jesus. So let's keep reading. Isaiah chapter verse 2. He will not shout, so I can read it for us.
He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the street.
He will not cry out or shout or raise his voice in the street. Meaning that he was meek, he was humble. Okay, he wasn't overbearing, he wasn't throwing weight around. He was meek, he walked to the prostitutes, you know, with the drunkards. He was with them, he loved them, he cared for them. He did not disown them. He was a meek, humble man. He didn't raise his voice, he was not overbearing. Alright, so we're going through Isaiah step by step, okay? Because I don't want Muslims to ever mention this again in their life. Verse 3.
So you're going to go through every verse, you're going to get to the point.
We're going
to,
yes we are, this is the point.
Yeah, am I going to get to
this is speak? Jesus. Yes you are.
When
I finish.
When you finish.
Yeah, go on, verse
3. Then narrows it down
and. Right, and the small thing weak, he will not bring forth justice.
Okay, so he's saying he will not crush the weakest reed or put a fickle flame. That means he was compassionate. I'm saying he didn't go after the weak, okay, or the leper, side. He was compassionate towards them. Verse 4, again, he speaks about
he will not conquer or discourage till he establishes justice. He was teaching the island will put their hope.
Right, there again, he's speaking about bringing justice
to
the earth.
To the Gentiles.
Okay, so he's going to be justice to all mankind. Okay.
Okay, now can you get to the point?
Keep, no, I'm going to verse 6.
Now it's my turn
verse
now.
Verse 6.
My
no,
turn.
Verse 6. No, 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 we're going to
my turn now.
No.
My turn now.
I let you finish. I told you when you finish.
Give him enough time.
No, I told you when you finish.
Am I being fair, Godwin?
Sir, I told you, no.
Listen, you gotta be fair.
I told you when I
gave you enough time.
No, I never stopped at any point.
Yes, you did.
Ages.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't. I said when you finish, and I never
stopped.
So verse 6.
Can
you read that again?
I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of any of your
rights. Listen, if I wanted to hear this, I'd go to church. Please give me the point. Yeah, I'll go listen to Jimmy Swagger.
Carry on.
Right, so Jesus Christ in Hebrews chapter 9 verse 15.
Who's Hebrews?
Get to the Hebrews, point. Yeah. He brought, the Bible says that he brought a new covenant. Okay. If you read throughout Hebrews 9 15, okay. It speaks about this new covenant.
Okay, can I respond?
No, let me finish.
Matthew 20:28
as well, yes, absolutely. Okay, verse 7. Let's read that.
So open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prisoners, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness.
How right. Did Muhammad do this? Right, this is powerful. Because it says here, you open eyes of the blind.
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
Did Muhammad open the eyes of the blind?
Do you know
no.
What that means?
No, I'm not. I've finished.
You know what that means?
I haven't finished.
Do you know
to
what that means?
To free captives from prison.
Okay. Yeah, well,
did Muhammad freed them? But Muhammad put people in prison.
Okay, okay.
Okay. Jesus never put anyone in prison.
Okay, so he never freed no one from prison.
And to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness.
Okay.
That's what Jesus, that's what the Bible calls.
Can I respond now?
Let me finish. You have to calm yourself down. You have to calm yourself down. We're doing Bible study today. Okay. Sorry, next verse. We're going through every single verse.
Listen, you're not going to go through the whole
yeah,
book.
Yeah, we are. Verse 10.
What? I'm giving
verse
you
10. This is
one second.
Okay.
This is the last verse. The last verse.
Okay, two more verses.
No, last verse.
Yeah, no, two more
I'm
verses.
Going to be fair.
Two more verses. Two
last
verses.
Verse.
He's going through the whole Bible.
Well, read 10, please.
He's going through the whole Bible.
To the Lord,
he's going through the whole Bible.
He's praying from the end of the earth, and you will go down to the sea. And all that, isn't it? You islands and all that live in
there. Right. That's verse 10.
Okay, can I respond
now? Hold on. Sorry. Yeah. I haven't finished. Yeah? Keep reading, man. So,
listen, they're going to edit all this out, you know, no one's going to hear this if you carry on.
And all who live in them, let the wilderness and its crown raise their voices, let the settlements where Kedar lives rejoice.
I'll say that louder.
Let the people of Selah sing for
joy. No, read that verse again.
Let them shout
for mercy. Let the settlements of Ruth.
Yeah, we will do that.
Let the settlements of Ruth.
Let me explain. Listen, I know it's hard.
Very hard to listen to you.
Thank you. To take the pressure.
Very hard to
listen. But it's going to happen today. It's going to happen. Wherever you like it,
maybe hard to listen to you.
Carry on. So, clearly saying, okay, seek the Lord, praise Him, arise from the ends of the earth, all parts of it. So it's saying, people who go down to the sea, and all those who are in it, people, yeah, your islands, people who dwell in these, so it speaks about islands, people who dwell in the islands,
yeah,
people in the wilderness, people from Kedar.
I told you don't exist.
Hold on. People from Selah, people on the mountaintops, all people, okay? It's speaking about plural people, right?
Yeah,
okay? It's not speaking about a man from Kedar.
Yeah.
It's speaking about a people.
A servant who will go to them, right. Yeah?
No, it doesn't say servant.
So that's not about servant.
It's people.
Yeah, a servant who goes to them people.
Wait, how does a servant mean people?
My turn now.
Last verse, and then you can end your turn. Last verse. Okay, the Lord will march out like a champion, like a warrior. He will stir up his zeal. He will shout, he will raise the battle cry, and he will triumph over his enemies. Okay. Here, speaking of again about Jesus coming back to judge mankind, he will be triumphant over his enemies. He's speaking about Jesus Christ, the second coming. And so what I'm saying to you is this, is that we know that Muhammad did not set no captive free. We know that Muhammad, he did not make any blind person see. We know that for a fact. When we know that these are fulfilled through Jesus Christ, we know that this text, the scripture we're reading, is fulfilled in the book of Matthew. Okay? So the question is, why on earth do you think, where on earth does it say Muhammad? Right. Or where does it refer
back to
Muhammad?
Me now?
Yes.
All right, everybody, let's recap now, yeah? First point is, this servant will have to deal with the Gentiles. This is what Jesus said, yeah, and he never responded. Matthew chapter 15, verse 22. And behold, a Canaanite woman of that district came and called out, "Have pity on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not say a word in answer to her. His disciples came and asked him, "Send her away, for she keeps calling out after us." He said in reply, "I was only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But the woman came and did him homage, saying, "Lord, help me." He said in reply, "It is not right to take the food of the children and throw it to the dogs." Yeah? So, the servant of Isaiah 42, he has to be for the Gentiles. Jesus calls the Gentiles dogs. Point number one. Point number two.
Well, let me think of one point.
If you don't do something now.
Let him speak.
Let him speak.
Yeah? Point number two. In Isaiah 42, he says, which prison did Muhammad take people out of? He put people in prison and Jesus opened the eyes of the blind. He doesn't know, and he needs to read biblical scholarship. That's a metaphor for taking people out of paganism, because it also says, wait, I ain't finished. It says he will open the eyes of the blind, open the ears of the deaf, take people out the dungeon, bring people into light. And in Isaiah 35, it says the same things will happen in the desert and the land will be restored. Jesus never went in the desert and opened nobody's eyes. He was in Jerusalem, so that doesn't apply to him. The next point is, he quoted the verse where it says the people of Kedah, the Arabs, descendants of Ishmael, will rejoice. Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Where does it say the descendants of Ishmael?
Okay, 1 second.
Let me speak.
You said, where does it say the descendants of Ishmael?
I'm saying, okay, I said
carry on, carry on.
Let me finish. Let me finish. The people of the descendants of Ishmael, Kedah, Genesis 25, the second son of Ishmael is Kedah, and he obviously didn't live at the time of Jesus or Muhammad, so Kedah refers to his descendants, just like Judah refers to the descendants of Judah. So the people of Kedah will rejoice when the servant comes. According to him, Kedah died 1,000 years before in the time of Isaiah, so he has to explain that. Number two, when did Jesus come to the descendants of Ishmael and make them rejoice, shout from the mountaintops the praises of God? And he also says the servant will come to Mount Salah. Go type in Google where Mount Salah is. It's a mountain in Medina. So tell everybody here, when Jesus went to Mecca and Medina and the Hijaz, over to you.
This is all just bullet talk. You're just rambling on.
Right,
you're not dealing with the subject. You're not dealing with the scripture. You're not dealing with the text.
Answer that point.
Right. So the first point you made, okay, is that about the woman, the sacrificial there? Yeah, we got that there, yeah? Right. Do you know what he's talking about?
Yes, brother. Yes, man. Listen, man.
Do you understand this verse?
According to you, no.
No. Do you understand this?
Yes. Okay. Better than you.
Okay, so what analogous and what parallel is Jesus drawing?
You tell me.
No, you tell me. You made a point. Do you know? If you don't know, say I don't know.
You're humble. You said I don't know.
Don't act like you know all. Do you know what?
And then, I know David's a prophet.
What's the parallel? Yeah. See, this is called a had a homily. You're trying to throw a red herring. Trying to change the subject. Deal with the subject, okay? Do you know what that parallel got Jesus that is being drawn in this text?
I don't have the Holy Spirit. You tell me.
Do you know, yes or no? I just want to know.
I don't know what you know, no?
I'm asking you. You don't know.
Not what you know.
Why are you humbling yourself? Let's say this. I don't know.
I don't know what you know. Right. I don't know what Godwin knows.
Right. The analogous, which is clearly being shown.
Okay, right, very clear.
Is a Jewish household.
Yeah.
Okay. And the world.
Yeah.
Okay. You have a Jewish household and the world.
Yeah.
Right. You have in a Jewish household, you have the mother and the father who brings food into into the household, okay? Just as we had God who would bring his word. Word, the Bible says, is meat, is the bread of life. So it's the word, he would bring food, the words to his people. There's only two people, two types of people or types of people in the world, and that's Jews and Gentiles, okay? And the analogous is in the household, there were just the dogs and the children that need to eat, need food. And so what he's saying here, he's saying, listen, in priority, yeah, he's prioritizing. He's saying that first, it must come. He's not calling the woman just a dog. He's simply saying that the Jews first are going to receive the news, the gospel. The Jews will then, through the Jews, the gospel will be spread to all the earth, to all the Gentiles. Whereas the woman understood this, because she understood that, because he was speaking about the children are priority. They're going to be fed, and then the dogs and then the animals will receive it. And so he wasn't simply saying that the woman is a dog, he wasn't disrespecting her or calling her name, he was saying that she was simply saying, using her priority order. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Can I respond to this?
Yes, you can.
Okay. Everybody, this is what happens when you go to church every Sunday, listen to Jimmy Swagger and don't read biblical scholarship. Yeah? Matthew chapter 15 and Matthew chapter 10 represents what the historical Jesus said. Biblical scholars such as James D.G. Dunn, Bart Ehrman, E.B. Sanders, Hyam Maccabee say that this reflects what the historical Jesus said, and it was later Christians who claimed this for the whole world. In fact, in this New American Bible, not a Muslim Bible, yeah? On the commentary of Matthew chapter 10, are you not listening?
I'm listening, I'm listening to everybody you're saying. I'm listening. Yeah?
The commentary on Matthew chapter 10 verse 5 to 6 and Matthew chapter 15 verse 24, this is what they say. The 12 disciples are sent only to Israel. This saying may reflect an original Jewish Christian refusal of the mission to the Gentiles, but for Matthew it expresses rather the limitation that Jesus himself observed during his ministry. You hear that? I ain't finished. Yeah. So, now, the problem is, number one, the servant of Isaiah 42 has to come to the Gentiles. Jesus called the Gentiles dogs, and his own scholars and this commentary admit he was only for the Jews. Number two, he said that Kedar would be finished within a year of Isaiah 21.
Let's take a walk quick. I showed, number one,
Isaiah 21 is a fulfillment in the life of the prophet Muhammad on New Peace. Number two, how Kedar exists in Isaiah 42. Number three, the servant of Isaiah 42, when he comes, he will go to the descendant of Ishmael to the mountain in Medina. He hasn't showed us that Jesus went. Show me where Matthew says Jesus went to Makkah or Medina, and you win the debate. So far, it's nearly four. Show me where Matthew says Jesus went to the people of Makkah and Medina.
You said in Isaiah chapter 42.
Yeah.
That person would go to Kedar.
Yes.
Show us that.
Well, how will they rejoice?
How will they rejoice? You're the exegetes.
One minute.
You're filling in the gap. It doesn't say that.
The servant of Isaiah 42 will be a light to the Gentiles. When he comes, the people of Ishmael and Medina will rejoice. Read the verse.
Verse 42, yeah.
Okay.
Chapter
42.
Yeah, after what?
Let the wilderness, the desert, and its towns raise their voices.
Right.
Let the settlements where Kedar, the descendants of Ishmael, live, rejoice.
Right.
Let the people of Selah sing for joy.
Yes.
Let them shout from the mountaintops. Right. Let them give glory to the Lord.
Let them sing. Let them rejoice.
Yeah.
Where does it say that?
That's the mission of the servant.
It doesn't say that there.
Okay.
You're superimposing your presupposition of what you believe. It doesn't say that.
Understand.
So let me respond to what you just said.
Let me finish. The point I'm trying to make is the mission of this servant is for the Gentiles and the people of Ishmael and Medina. So if you're saying that it's about Jesus, when did this happen? That's my point. You understand?
Okay, let me go to East Brooklyn. Clearly, you didn't understand about the Sunnitian woman. Clearly, understand.
Well, I gave you your own commentary.
Let's start with that.
Are they wrong?
Let's start with that.
Okay.
You're talking about the commentary, okay? You use scholars, okay, to approve your position, right? Now, majority of New Testament scholars believe that Jesus Christ died. Okay, majority of New Testament scholars. In fact, Bart Ehrman says one irrefutable fact is that Jesus Christ definitely lived and died.
Okay.
Did Jesus live? Did Jesus die?